Hello, I'm Senator Harry Reid. Welcome to this new edition of Reid All About It. Today we'll start with a very important moment in Nevada history, the day we installed our second state statue in the rotunda of the United States Capitol. This area is called Statuary Hall. Every state can put two and only two statues there. Many years ago, Nevada donated a statue to one of its famous citizens, former Senator Pat McCarran, to be placed in Statuary Hall. But for 45 years, we had no other statue to represent us. But this year, we finally added our second to the Capitol's collection. For the subject, we chose a brave, intelligent, and hardworking Nevadan, Sarah Winnemucca. Sarah was a Native American of the Paiute tribe. She lived in the late 1800s in northern Nevada. She was an educator and a writer. She worked to preserve Native culture and improve race relations all over the country. Her statue was unveiled in a beautiful ceremony. Sarah's life, though, is a story of firsts. She was the first female Native American to write a book. She set up Nevada's first school for Native American children. She was one of the first to navigate between her own culture and the settlers. As someone who showed so much courage in charting a new course, Sarah's statue fits in well among other first Americans in the Capitol.
I'd like to welcome Mr. Ralph Burns from the Paiute Lake Indian Tribe from the Pyramid Lake Paiute Tribe for a Native American blessing in the Paiute language. Mr. Burns?
Usa makanuka. Ya manipuni, fshetu mia, kondomita mia na fshetu kocha. Manospa. Huwa, huwa.
Now, the moment we've all waited for, the opportunity for us all to enjoy what we came here today. It's my pleasure, along with Senator Reid, Senator Ensign, to help unveil the second statue of Nevada, Sarah Winnemucca.
The sculptor who created Sarah Winnemucca's statue is Benjamin Victor. He's only 26 years old, the youngest artist ever to create a work for Statuary Hall. Now, my little Sarah here, I got by going to Carson City, where he was putting the finishing touches on the real big Sarah Winnemucca that's now upstairs in Statuary Hall. I just fell in love with the work that he did, just like the people who were the jurors who picked who would do the work for the people of the state of Nevada for our statue. It was just overwhelming. It was so beautiful. So I said, could I get a small one like that? And he said, yeah, I'm making a few of them. You can have the first one. Well, I learned the next day my wife was going to come by and look at it. So I told all the staff there, don't tell my wife that I bought one of these. But sure enough, my wife met Benjamin, and I hadn't told him. And he was so proud that I had purchased this statue right here that he told my wife. And it was easy with my wife. She fell in love with Sarah just like I did. Sarah is now for every person that comes from Nevada to my office to see. I'm so proud of this. It's in my conference room here in the United States Capitol. And I like it as much today as I did when I first saw it. Sarah Winnemucca is now the eighth woman to be represented in Statuary Hall. She also is one of several statues of Native Americans. In fact, throughout the artwork in the Capitol, you can see the influence of Native Americans. But now, Native American culture is more visible than ever before, for a lot of reasons, not the least of which is Smithsonian's National Museum of the American Indian. It's brand new. It opened less than a year ago. It has an incredible collection, including many pieces from Nevada. I recently had a chance to go to the museum for the second time, but this time I met its director. Let's take a look at my visit. Rick, thank you very much for being here today. This is a great pleasure for me and an honor for the people of State of Nevada to, for the first time, to be exposed to this great new museum, one of a kind.
Well, I appreciate that, and we're delighted to have you here, and delighted to be coming up on our celebration of our first anniversary here on the National Mall, having opened last September.
And talking to you indicated, what do you know about Indians? Well, you're part Indian.
Yes, I am. Yes, I'm a Southern Cheyenne, and I belong to the Cheyenne and Arapaho tribes of Oklahoma. Grew up in the state of Oklahoma. My father, who was the Indian side of my family, was a very distinguished Native American painter. We were raised as Cheyennes. My brother and I have remained very close to the tribe. I belong to the Society of Chiefs of the Southern Cheyenne in Oklahoma right now.
Oh, that's wonderful. Tell the people in Little Nevada a little about you. You have a little bit, but your background, why you would be the director of this wonderful museum.
Well, it's a long story. I'm trained as a lawyer, and I practiced for a large law firm here in Washington, D.C. for 20 years or so, but representing Indian tribes. What led here was really my genes, I suppose. My father's interest in art had me growing up around museums. The Smithsonian Institution wanted somebody who was native to actually be the director, if at all possible. They wanted somebody who had genuine connections to the community, genuine connections to native art and culture. And most of all, they wanted somebody who supposedly was comfortable wandering around your territory up on Capitol Hill.
Why is this good for the American people?
I think this is good for the American people for a couple of different reasons. First of all, I think to the extent that there are still significant numbers of Native people in the United States, which there are, 2 million as a matter of the federal rolls, probably even more as a matter of self-identification, this is a tremendous affirmation, if you will, of the part they have played in the grand sweep of American history and culture. And I think that's very important. But the National Museum of the American Indian, in the end, is really about a profound reconciliation amongst both natives and non-natives in this country. And so this place is equally important to the non-native visitors who come here, who are most of our visitors, some 3 to 4 million per year, as a place where they can learn something about what is a part of their own heritage too, Native America. That's part of all of America's heritage, not just people who are Indian themselves.
We have about 22 different tribes and colonies and different groups of people who are identified as Indians in the state of Nevada. And I think Nevada is going through a period in history, just like the rest of the country, where people have suddenly become proud that they're an Indian. In the past, you know, there was almost a stigma on if you're an Indian, don't admit it, you know. Mm-hmm. But now people are proud. Their culture is coming back. The Paiutes, for example, I went to a meeting at Pyramid Lake, and they had a couple of the elders teaching the kids the language, which is being lost.
I know.
So this is coming at a perfect time in the history of our country.
Native people now, I think, feel very different about themselves, their cultures, the worthiness of their communities than they did a half century ago when I was growing up.
There's no doubt about that. It's so nice that we have this place, and I want to put in a plug for a couple of people. The most, in my estimation, the most important person for this museum was a man by the name of Dan Inouye. He became chairman of the Indian Affairs Committee and took it as a personal mission. He worked very hard to get this done. And then, of course, Knight Horse Campbell was also important.
Of course, of course. Dan Inouye was probably our principal angel. We had a number of angels on the Hill, if you will, and you actually were one of them yourself, because I remember your co-sponsorship of our authorizing legislation. But Dan Inouye in particular, as you point out, kept this place very close to him, as did Ben Knight Horse Campbell, my fellow Cheyenne.
We're going to look at later at some Nevada things in the museum, but I'd like people in Nevada to hear from you, because I've told anyone, well, listen, I'm not sure they think I have the background to substantiate it. But vast majority of the collection we have comes from one person, isn't that right?
George Gustav High was a collector who collected obsessively, really, for about a half century.
He even lost a wife or two as a result of that.
One time one of the wives said, it's either the collection or me, and she moved out the next day. So he kept only those near him who would endure his passion for collecting. But over a period of about a half century, he collected 800,000 objects, stretching from Tierra del Fuego in South America to the Arctic Circle in the north, making this really a collection of the Americas, not even just of the United States. 30% of our collection is from Latin America.
That's a story in itself.
It is.
This good man who, as a result of his work, we have things for generations to come that will come out as, we couldn't possibly put all this stuff, 800,000 in this
museum. No, we cannot.
Why is this museum different than any other museum on the mall?
Well, I think this museum is different for a couple of reasons. We refer to even this building as being a native place. And what we mean by that is it somehow is infused with that which bespeaks Native American. The minute you step on this site, as you probably know, just given the...
Even on the outside you can tell.
That's correct, because the plantings are from about 200 to 300 different species native to this area when this little piece of marshland was actually Native America itself. And so you know that when you're coming in. We've had both natives and non-natives walk into this building and say, this is a very different kind of experience. There's almost a spiritual dimension to standing in this space. And that makes it somewhat different. The other thing which makes it very different in my view is that this, notwithstanding this remarkable collection, which you and I have just been talking about, is not simply a palace of collectibles. This is also about the people who made that material and the combination of those peoples and those collections in the communities which through time and at the present have sustained Native America. And that's a little bit different. It makes it almost a cultural center rather than just a house of collections.
We're in this great big place here, very unlike most museums. Mm-hmm. Why is the architecture so differently? And around us we don't see a lot of things. This is just a space. Why?
Well, let me tell you just a little bit about the architecture. The architecture design was developed in collaboration with Native peoples themselves. We had, over a period of 2.5 to 3 years, 25 to 30 consultations with Native people and others throughout the Americas, really, about this building. Out of it came a number of themes that you see in the building. Its organic nature, its curvilinearity, because most Native design is taken from nature. You don't see many straight lines and right angles in nature, and so the very curvilinearity of the building reflects that. The infusion of natural light into this space is also indicative of that. The water element on the outside of the building, the plantings that are outside of the building, all of these are making Native statements of one sort or another in an abstract form. This isn't a concrete teepee, but this is an abstraction of Native design aesthetics that have come down through the ages. Now, this space itself is called the Potomac, and it indeed is a grand gathering space for the museum. And the fundamental reason we have it is because Native experience and culture is not just the wonderful objects that you see by the hundreds in the galleries of the museum, it's also performing art, dance, music, storytelling, all of which takes place right in this space. We even have a wooden floor instead of a stone floor for those of us aging dancers whose knees can't take stone any longer and who use the wood to soften the blows, if you will. But this space itself is a wonderful reflection of the museum. Lots of people, for example, come in, take a look at that dome and say,
how high is that?
It is the full height of the building. It's 5 stories high. It's about 120 feet high. The prism right behind me, which casts sunlight onto the floor here, marks the seasons. It marks the solstices and the equinoxes. And on the summer equinox, which happened not that terribly long ago, those crystals line up in a way that you have a rainbow image almost directly behind you on this side. So it's that element of time, as Native people see it, the cycles. All of those are statements which come to us in this space.
Tell us some other unique things about this facility.
Well, the way in which we organize our exhibitions, for example, which is the main reason most people come to a museum, is a little bit different here. Lots of exhibitions of the great materials, such as we have, are organized around particular categories, the baskets, the pots, the clothing, by categories in that way, or they're organized along a very tight timeline. We did not do that because we didn't feel that that was the way that Native peoples themselves would think about and interpret their own history and experience. And so we organized our exhibitions according to themes. our universes, which has to do with Native cosmology and philosophy, our peoples, which has to do with Native histories, but told from a Native standpoint, our lives is really about the contemporary experience of Native peoples, which is very much about the National Museum of the American Indians invoking the Native voice in telling stories. We greatly respect other systems of knowledge, anthropology, archaeology, art history, but we also believe that Native peoples themselves can add to this table of conversation.
But you even carried this over into the dining room, the cafeteria.
Yes, we did. We did. I mean, to be frank, it was suggested, because that's what was happening at the Smithsonian at the time, that we might bring in, even a fast food outlet in the National Museum of the American Indian. Not that that doesn't present quality food also, but we wanted to make a program.
Although that's debatable.
I will leave that to you, Senator. But we wanted the cafeteria to be itself a programmatic statement. And so we actually are working with the same caterers that serve the rest of the Smithsonian.
Wow.
But we got them excited about doing a Native menu, if you will.
So for example?
We have salmon that's flown in daily, wild salmon that's flown in daily, that is part of the Northwest Coast part of the cafeteria. It is the Northwest Coast, the northeast part of the United States, the Great Plains.
Wow.
You know, a Cheyenne director would not allow you not to have bison somewhere on the menu. Central America and South America. And it is vastly popular. It is one of the leading money makers in the Smithsonian now, even though there are other museums bigger than we are. And it is very popular. I've seen some of my blue and gray-suited fellow former lawyers just wandering across the mall to have lunch at the cafeteria.
What's a powwow?
A powwow is a wonderful intertribal gathering.
You still have them?
Well, we do still have them, and we're going to have one in the middle part of August, August 12th, 13th, 14th.
That means Native Americans will come here?
Absolutely, and we plan on having probably anywhere from 500 to 700 dancers, which is a very sizable powwow. And it will be right here in Washington, but I want to say and emphasize, since it is in mid-August, in air-conditioned comfort in the MCI Center in downtown Washington, D.C. But it is our second powwow. We're delighted to have it. I think we have become a part of the national powwow circuit, and people will expect us to do this every couple of years, and we will. But it's a wonderful occasion of socializing amongst Indians and amongst non-natives with Indians. It is celebration, it is culture, it is art.
Well, now we're here where we're going to be able to see a few of the objects. And I say just a few. We have thousands and thousands of articles.
Yes, we have thousands here, but we have hundreds of thousands elsewhere because the space just won't take it.
I was raised in Southern Nevada. I'll have to make sure you get a copy of my book, because we have one of my chapters is about an Indian in my hometown of Searchlight. I'd like that very much. But I've come to the realization that the quality of the art, the craftsmanship of Native Americans is unbelievable. People in Nevada could do wonderful things. We have in your museum here one of the cradle boards from Nevada. And I was joking with you that I have a beautiful cradle board of myself, my own, that was given to me by the Pyramid Paiute tribe. For example, the baskets. I don't know, there may be a more famous basket maker someplace in Native American country, but we have one, Datse Latse.
Mm-hmm.
Her baskets sell for as much as $1 million.
There are not many more famous than she. She really is truly one of the remarkable, remarkable basket weavers.
Well, the admiration that I have for her is so significant that I went and visited her gravesite in Carson City.
Just to
sit there and contemplate what a great artist she was, and frankly, how people took advantage of her and her family.
Mm-hmm.
She was really, to me, is what artist is all about.
I agree with that. And she grew up at a very difficult time as an artist. It was a time when Native people were making a transition into the commercial market. They didn't know much about the commercial market, and they were taken advantage of often in those kinds of settings. But her art is still with us, and that's probably the most important thing. And of course, basket weaving as an art amongst the Paiute and in Nevada was at a very, very high level. When you get to the western part of the United States, but including, I say quite emphatically, Nevada, you see basket weaving as a fine, fine art in terms of the technique and the quality of the decoration. And in the case of the baskets that we have right here that are from the Bata, the beautiful woven and beaded basket that is really from the 1960s, we would consider it a fairly contemporary object. You can see the fineness of the technique and the fineness of the design in the work. It's really of the absolute highest quality. Well, as you can see in the cases which we're just looking at, there is such diversity. These particular cases are only beadwork, and you see beadwork probably from 60 or 70 different tribes. Lots of tribes used it, and you can see the nature of the artistic talent that was brought to bear on this.
And it's so, so nice that we have this facility. Not only baskets, but ceramics, bowls, cups. I personally have in my home in Searchlight a number of the Navajo pots, pottery.
Yes.
One thing we learned about them, we bought this beautiful pot, but my wife put flowers in it and left the water in it. Not good.
No, not good. Because those pots are usually not fired very long.
That's right.
They're soft.
They're to look at.
They're to look at and not to hold water. Yeah. There were some pots that did hold water, but mostly.
Some of the baskets the Washoes used, Washoe tribe in Nevada, those baskets that they wove were used to cook in.
I know.
They used to cook in, and they would last for several years. It's hard to comprehend that, but that's
what
they did.
Sitting on a fire.
What they did is they would put water in there and then put very hot stones in it, and they'd keep putting the stones in and cook the food in them. So.
Yeah. No, that's, and so baskets were quite utilitarian.
My brother in Searchlight, Nevada, we had a few Indians there in times past, but not many. He found an arrowhead, Searchlight, Nevada. Other places in Nevada, there are lots of them. Former Congressman Jim Santini was an avid collector of what we called arrowheads. He's got a wonderful collection, but of course, as hard as he's worked his whole life, it pales in comparison to the magnificent display that you have here. And we're happy that you have something from Nevada here.
Oh, we
do. Native American arrowheads.
Yes, they're from Pershing County in Nevada, and they are really, they're beautiful points. And again, it's this wonderful combination of something that was obviously purely utilitarian in some respects. These weren't hung up on walls; they were used for hunting and for surviving and subsistence. And yet, you look at those, and we have an explanation also up there of what is involved in carving a point and the complexity of it. And they are wonderful to look at just from an artistic standpoint.
Well, we still have Native Americans in Lovelock, Pershing County. Mm-hmm. It's a community that about 90 miles out of Reno. And it's growing a little bit now. Mm-hmm. And we hope that as a result of, again, recognizing that we have something here in this great museum from Pershing County, Lovelock, that we should get some people from Lovelock to come visit.
We should. We want everybody from wherever they are in this hemisphere, including Nevada, obviously, to see themselves in this place. If they're Indian, they see themselves quite literally sometimes. Even if they're non-native Nevadans, they see something about where they come from in this place. What's remarkable and what you see here is the great diversity of Native America. I think lots of times people don't understand fully that fact, that right now there are 574 federally recognized tribes in the United States, to say nothing of 60 to 70 state recognized tribes that can be added to that list. And what we're trying to show in these particular cases is that great diversity and that great breadth and depth of richness in art and Native art making.
I wish the viewers could have been with us a little earlier while the TV folks were setting up, because I walked with you through some of the exhibits, and you could identify this from this tribe, this from this tribe, just by looking at it. And it's hard for me to explain to the people in Nevada the beauty of Indian art, the beauty, the color, richness of the colors, the fineness of the beadwork, the stitching, the colors. And a lot of the colors, well, they didn't go down to a store and buy the dye. This is from native
plants. That's correct. That's correct. Mm-hmm. They were natural colors. And
I've read a lot about our Washoe famous basket maker in Nevada that we've already talked about. Mm-hmm. The trouble she went to get the colors for her baskets, really difficult to comprehend.
And the materials, really. And that's one thing that we should all be aware of, is that this is also a contemporary art. It's going on right now. And one of the problems that native basket makers most face is the fact that because of everything from urban expansion to environmental difficulties, they cannot get the materials that they need to do the basket making. This is true in both Nevada and California.
Let me say thank you so much for taking this time with me. I do hope that people in Nevada come to appreciate the Native Americans that we have in Nevada. We need to understand that as we have seen things here from Nevada, they also in their tribes and colonies and gatherings in Nevada, they dance, they weave, they're trying to preserve their language. So I hope people better appreciate who we have in Nevada. And also, you and I invite them to Washington, D.C. to see this magnificent museum. No other place like it in the world. You walk by here, you know that it's a Native American. You come inside, even if you didn't see the arch, you would know it's something different here. What a wonderful place to work.
Yes, it is. I consider my journey as the director of this museum a blessed one. I truly do. And I hope that people will take you at your word that this is a place for everybody to explore this vital element of their heritage, that these are people with a distinguished and deep history, but that they're right here, right now, still continuing in their cultures as they have in the past.
And the entrance fee is?
Zero. It's free. Thank you.
If you'd like to know more about the museum, you can check their website or my website. We'll put those addresses up on the screen in just a moment. Thank you for watching. I'll be back soon for another edition of Read All About It.